specifically, if that is, they are epithelial cells, but specifically what part of the integument is this?
Dermis?
Close, the epidermis. And then this tan stuff under here is the dermis, John. This is all dermis.
Oh, I didn't see, I was looking at my computer, I'm sorry, I didn't see your red pointer.
Oh, okay, yeah. So you know, this is the epidermis, here's the dermis. Within the dermis, you have a whole bunch of capillaries, and that's represented by this thing down here. This is a capillary. It's real thin. At the level of the capillary, that's where cells and molecules can leave the circulatory system, because the wall is so thin and permeable. So here's the splinter. Comes in to your skin. Here's the green things are bacteria. And they are releasing all sorts of chemicals, and they also come in with their PAMPs. So you can see right here, immediately if there's a phagocyte in the area, they could start phagocytosing the bacteria. Well, let's check this out. So step one says inflammatory chemicals. You get inflammatory chemicals from lots of different places. The tissue, these cells that got damaged, they'll release chemicals saying, hey, I was damaged. Let's start inflammation. And everybody's, have y'all had a splinter and seen that it got red and everything? So that's inflammation. So that's step one. Inflammatory chemicals are released from a variety of cells. Step two then takes place down here in the capillary with neutrophils. How do you know this is the neutrophil?
Multinucleated?
Yeah, the multi-lobed nucleus. Not multinucleated, because that would mean more than one nucleus. It's just a single nucleus with lots of lobes. And what happens is, when this area gets damaged, it causes these epithelial cells, so there's a lot of cell types in this cartoon. These guys right here are epithelial cells. Mm-hmm. They line the capillary. They're going to secrete molecules, these epithelial cells will secrete molecules that make leaky tight junctions between them so that the neutrophils can leave the bloodstream and get to the battlefield. So increased permeability of the capillary wall, that means the endothelial cells loosen up their tight junctions. And then also the endothelial cells secrete a sticky substance so that the neutrophils can do this thing called margination. So if neutrophils are usually floating freely in the center of the blood vessel and they encounter this sticky chemical on an endothelial cell, they will marginate. That means they go to the margins of the blood vessel. Now just remember, this whole process is we want to get neutrophils and macrophages to the battlefield so they can take care of the bacteria. So the neutrophils marginate, and then what they do, they crawl through those leaky tight junctions in a process called diapedesis. So you've heard of pedestrian, right? Pedi is foot. So these guys are diapedesing. The cells are walking or crawling through these leaky tight junctions to get to the battlefield. And then because all these inflammatory chemicals are here at the battlefield site, the neutrophils can do this process called chemotaxis. That means they move along a chemical gradient to get to where they're supposed to be, which is the area where the bacteria are. And then they can do their phagocytosis. So let's see for the test, we've got, I forgot to mention these guys, mast cells. I think I told you this earlier, mast cells are just basophils that have crawled into the tissue. So basophils secrete histamine, which we've talked about before, antihistamines. You can buy an antihistamine. Basophils cause vasodilation. What's that? Your blood vessels get bigger. They dilate. Why would you want it tells you right there. Why do you want to increase blood flow? get white blood cells to the battlefield quickly. The bigger the vessel is, the more white blood cells can get to that spot. Histamine also, and other chemicals, increase capillary permeability. And then I talked about this, so the white blood cells can marginate. So what the neutrophil is doing is diapedesis, but then moving from inside the vessel to outside the vessel is called extravasation. So they're leaving, going outside the vessel, the vasa, and then chemotaxis along your chemical gradient. You two in the back, right? Where's your card?
Oh, I'm still.
You're still. Oh, no, I'm still, I was looking behind you. No, I know you're still thinking. Where's your card? Home? If you said C, you are correct. They're all the all those inflammatory chemicals that was on the previous cartoon, they all do vasodilation. They all want to make the blood vessel bigger to get more cells to the area. Try again. If you said D, you are... D for diapedesis. Thank you. I was a theater major. Just kidding, I wasn't a theater major. So let's do some key molecules overview. We've seen this cartoon before, right?
Mm-hmm.
The clotting cascade. And then here's a, I think this is a scanning electron micrograph that they cut out of a blood clot. It's also called a thrombus. Have you heard of that? Thrombus, instead of the word clot, they call it a thrombus. Well, anyway, there you go. Here's the thrombus. Here's fibrin, the fibrin polymer making the clot. And then there's this molecule called heparin, and it will activate another enzyme called antithrombin. So heparin is a key molecule in the immune system, but if you activate, if you're heparin and you activate antithrombin, what do you think antithrombin does?
Keeps blood from clotting?
Keeps blood from clotting. Yeah, exactly. So basophils secrete heparin. Heparin activates antithrombin. It's an anti-clotting molecule or anti-coagulant. So it prevents clots in that area where the battlefield is. It prevents clots because if you have clots in the area where bacteria are, you're going to slow white blood cells getting to the battlefield to kill the bacteria. So just in that area, you want to release antithrombin. So you want to get as much blood to that area as you can. And you don't want any possibility for clotting in that area because that would slow blood flow to the battlefield. So questions on this? More molecules. So now remember, we're not in cell types. Remember to make your list. These are all cells in the immune system. These are all molecules in the immune system. So key molecules continue. Perforin proteins, we've already talked about these. Perforins are molecules that form a hole in the target cell. And it says here, and then it disrupts osmotic homeostasis. So perforins themselves, if you didn't have granzyme to do apoptosis and you just put in perforins, now you poked a hole in that enemy cell. Now that enemy cell is going to be osmotically disrupted. So water is going to rush in or rush out, depends on the surrounding fluid. But you've osmotically disrupted that enemy cell. So it's going to die. With just perforins, it can die. There are proteins in your blood that are circulating right now that also form a hole. So instead of perforin proteins forming that hole in the cell, these complement proteins can also punch a hole in the enemy cell. And this is called the MAC, or the membrane attack complex. So what are the names of the two proteins that can make these structures that punch holes in the cells? That's in the name of the proteins, not the cells, the proteins. Perforins and complement. Can you kind of see, these look like barrel slats. It sounds like some kind of old-timey reference to the 1800s.
Beep, 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 beep.
It's a terrorist. Sorry, you take your mom and Mary's in your dog when she's leaving.
Oh,
that's
funny.
She got out of the car.
Oh,
that's just good comedy. The mother's embarrassing the daughter. So, you guys, can you imagine in your mind like a barrel? Like, I think of like an old Western movie. You have these big barrels with the slats. You know what I'm talking about? Like from the olden days. That's what this looks like to me. So each one of these complement proteins is a slat in the barrel. Each one of these perforin proteins down here is a slat in the barrel. And that barrel is open, and now water can move in and out of the cell freely, and it can't regulate its own osmotic homeostasis. So it bursts. The cell dies. Key molecules, then we're still on molecules. We're not doing cell types in immunity, we're doing molecules. Here's a cell. This purple thing is a nucleus. Here's an antigen. This little red thing is an antigen. And then here's this thing called an MHC protein. What is that? Yeah.
The receptor?
You have to match them in transplants. Yeah. So every single cell of your body has your own specific MHC proteins. So if you try to transplant my cells that have my MHC proteins into your body that have your MHC proteins, your immune system will say, hey, these are not my MHC proteins. I'm going to kill these transplanted cells.
I can see in this class how she made us.
I think that's how they first discovered it, and they were trying to do transplants. And they're like, why can't we transplant this tissue into this animal? And then we found, oh, there's these MHC proteins. I know you can transplant to immunosuppress, but I mean, you can only immunosuppress so much. So I'm not a surgeon. I'm not sure how that plays out. Have you had experience with that?
That's
what you remember, yeah.
Yeah.
Here's, because I love the military theme of the immune system, I'm going to say these MHC proteins are like your cell's dog tags. So every, so you know, in battlefield, you're dead or whatever, they recognize your body by your dog tags, right? So these MHC proteins are your cell's dog tags. And each cell of your body has your own unique MHC proteins. It's called major histocompatibility complex. That's what MHC stands for. And they're used to recognize self and non-self cells. So your immune system recognizes these MHC proteins as self proteins. Your immune system won't kill your own self cells because of these dog tags. But these MHC proteins can also present foreign antigens here for your immune system to recognize. Question, or are you just doing your hair?
Well, are there two types of MHC?
No, we're not there yet.
Okay, sorry.
No, it's exciting. There are MHC1 and MHC2. There's probably more than that.
Right.
But we study MHC1 and MHC2. I know, it's exciting. Immune system 2 is much more fun because you go into more detail. Antigen presentation uses MHC1 protein that you find on all nucleated cells. And then you find MHC2 proteins on antigen presenting cells. So if you are a nucleated cell in the body, like a lung cell or a liver cell, you can present a foreign antigen on your MHC1 dog tags. If you are an antigen presenting cell, you can present a foreign antigen in your MHC2 dog tags. So soon enough, I'm going to be talking about these MHC proteins like you completely understand them.
Great.
I know. So I'm just giving you a heads up. This is still just an overview. We haven't gotten to the details of anything yet. So in this cartoon, he shows an antigen, and that now instead of just saying you're an antigen, you're just a red ball here as an antigen, we're going to say there's specific parts of you as an antigen called epitopes, and those are the things that get recognized. So an antigen is just a molecule made up of epitopes, and the epitopes are things that the immune system can recognize. Overview is finished. So if you didn't really dig a lot of this stuff, you will, because we're going to go into detail later. I just wanted to present it to you kind of in an overview form so you can get all excited to study all weekend. And on Monday, when we come back, we can go really fast. So. Yeah. Antigen presenting cell. Pardon? Yep. More brain deadness. Exams, lectures. I see a lot of bees. You are correct. So here's the epidermis. Or the top layers of the epidermis. This is all epidermis too. And then this stuff is dermis. And yeah. See the dermal papillae pushing up into the epidermis. So this is just tells you nonspecific defenses. Our first line of defense is the skin. It's dry, doesn't have a lot of nutrients for bacteria. It's hard to get through the keratin. We talked about lysosome, we talked about sweat, and vaginal secretions are acidic. Microbes don't like that. So this loose connective tissue in the dermis is due to this acid called hyaluronic acid. And when you get bitten by a snake, the snake venom breaks down the hyaluronic acid in the dermis, and then the venom can get into the capillaries that are in the dermis. And then once your venom and urine capillaries, you can go to all tissues of the body and kill your victim.
And die.
Snake.
And then you're done.
Victory. Yeah, and then you're done. It's interesting though, this hyaluronic acid, I studied this when I studied heart development at the U of A. It's an important component in a developing embryonic heart. You need to have hyaluronic acid present to develop your little baby hearts. but it's also in your dermis. Mucous membranes. So in this cartoon, it says ciliated columnar epithelial cells. So you can see there a columnar, here's the cilia, and then there's a mucus layer on top, and look what's trapped in all the mucus. Pathogens, foreign bodies, like maybe asbestos.
Dynamite.
Yeah, it does look like dynamite, doesn't it? But I think it's a bacteria with a little flagella. That's what it is. So this is a mucous membrane. If you breathe something in, it's in your trachea, and it gets caught in the mucus layer, which way will these cilia beat? Will the cilia that are lining your trachea, will they beat upward towards your throat, or will the cilia beat downward to push the bacteria further down into your bronchial tree? Yeah, they'll beat upwards. Yeah. And then what about the cilia that are in your nasal cavity? They'll beat down. Yeah. Because the idea is you want to get those bacteria and mucus into your oral cavity so you can spit it out. Oh, that's so cute. There she is. Spitting it out. Oh. Oh, you can expel pathogens through vomit. Does anybody know what that's from? Yeah, Team America, World Police. Who knew that? Yeah, right. You guys, anybody seen Team America, World Police?
Yeah.
Just you. I know. Isn't that disgusting?
I love it.
America.
Yeah. It's a movie. Yeah, with puppets. It's from the guys that made South Park.
Yeah. Which of the following acts as a first line of defense? D, A, and C. You are correct. Oh, we already talked about this. This is good. So this is a cartoon, the immune cells in the second line of defense. We're still in nonspecific. So N, O with the slash through it is my shorthand for neutrophils. M with the O with the slash through it, that's my shorthand for macrophages. And then natural born killer cells. Here's our cells of the immune system with their toll-like receptors, or TLRs. Here's bacteria, parasite, virus, fungi, pathogenic DNA or RNA, like a DNA virus or an RNA virus. All of these things in your world that could get you and hurt you are recognized non-specifically by these toll-like receptors on neutrophils, macrophages, and natural killer cells. And they're non-specific immune cells. What are the two specific immune cells?
B cells.
B cells and
T cells,
yeah. And then I've got, now I tell you a little bit more about natural born killer cells. They're non-specific, I already told you that. They perform this thing called immune surveillance. So they are out there all the time, like, it's almost like a police force. They're surveilling the world, your world, with their toll-like receptors. And if they're toll-like receptors, yeah, like cops and robbers, exactly. And if their toll-like receptors find a PAMP, then they're gonna destroy that foreign cell. But a natural killer cell is not a phagocyte. Looks like I'm gonna try to ask a tricky test question, so that's why I wrote it that way. So when a PAMP binds a toll-like receptor, that stimulates the process of phagocytosis. Oh, we've looked at this before. Neutrophils can do phagocytosis, and they can also do the respiratory burst. And we talked about the respiratory burst is when the neutrophil secretes hydrogen peroxide, and then hypochlorite, that's just bleach. I don't think I told you that initially. I like this because there's a killing zone with bleach and hydrogen peroxide, the killing zone. And then I told you this earlier, killing zone kills the bacteria and the neutrophils. And here's a cartoon of eosinophils. Doesn't look like I'm going to ask a test question on this. But check it out. Here's a parasitic worm, this fluorescent green parasitic worm. Here's an eosinophil, and it's dumping toxic chemicals all along the parasitic worm. There actually would be a whole bunch of eosinophils dumping chemicals on the parasitic worm. DC. Okay. Instead of PC, it says DC. DC stands for dendritic cell. So that's hilarious. A little nerd humor. Macrophages, phagocytized pathogens. We talked about that. So if this is a macrophage, this part here, he's got a lot of toll-like receptors lined up in there, and they're all looking for PAMPs on bacteria so that they can phagocytose the bacteria. But now I'm going to add another level of complexity. If you are a foreign invader and complement, these complement proteins sort of bound to you, the foreign invader, then you're going to be more appetizing to a macrophage. So that process is called opsonization. So when you coat, kind of like you use frosting on a cake, when you coat a foreign invader with opsonins, now that foreign invader looks really appetizing to the macrophage, through the phagocyte. So opsonization is coating the foreign invader with, let's see, I wish I were more of a foodie, because then I could do some cool foodie terms. Of is appetizing. That's not really cool. But if you're an invader and you got opsonized, you just look 10 times more appetizing to a macrophage than you did before you got opsonized.
Tantalizing.
Covering.
Tantalizing.
Satiating.
Satiating. Yeah, those are good ones. Thank you.
Glazed.
What?
Glazed.
It's like a glaze. Yeah, an opsonization is like a glaze over the foreign invader. And what do you use as opsonins? Complement proteins. Okay, we talked about this. Antigen presenting cells present antigens. Basophils are mast cells in the tissue. So the three, in this slide, the three immune cells that we're talking about, monocytes, antigen presenting cells, and basophils. So if you kind of get lost in all the detail of the immune system, which everybody does, always go back to the title of the slide. So for example, I call this immune cells. So you should be focusing on the names of the cells in this slide. I think previously I had immune molecules. So focus on the names of the molecules and make your list. I think that would be helpful. Oh, here's the process of phagocytosis. So here's the microbe or some other particle. It doesn't show it here, but this microbe could be coated with PAMPs. You'd have toll-like receptors on the macrophage. And then you do all this, you have all these different steps to phagocytosis. But in the end, at the end of phagocytosis, the macrophage just releases material that's not toxic anymore. So it did all this stuff to the foreign invader to chop it up. And I don't think any of the, I'm not, this is all you have to know. You don't have to know the process of phagocytosis inside the cell. You just have to know this. And I just said this earlier, the toll-like receptors on the immune system cells recognize PAMPs on the foreign invaders. Toll-like receptors also recognize opsonins. What's the opsonin we just talked about in the previous slide?
Complementary.
Complement proteins. Yes. Complement proteins. And in this cartoon, foreign invader got coated with opsonins, these little half circles would be opsonins, could be complement proteins. And shows here this cell is going to recognize the foreign invader. Now this is a little tricky. This cell would be what kind of cell? Let's start with that guy.
A phagocyte?
Yeah, and which one, a macrophage or a neutrophil? And how do you know just from the cartoon?
Neutrophil.
Yeah, it's a neutrophil. Look at that, it's a multi-lobe nucleus. And what happens is the neutrophil is going to recognize an antibody, the antibody bound to the opsonin. The opsonin coated the foreign invader. Look at all those steps. That's pretty, that's kind of complicated. But he's doomed. And neutrophil's like, oh yeah, it looks like food because he's going to phagocytize or eat the foreign invader. This is an ant. Yeah, it does look, kind of looks like some kind of pitchfork or a
tuning fork.
Yeah, it's an antibody. It should be more Y shaped. Like, I would redraw this cartoon. I would draw it Y. Classic. Oh my gosh, what is this? Look at, so this is a cell, here's the extracellular fluid, here's inside the cell, here's the nucleus, and look at all the different TLRs there are. It's all like receptor 2, TLR4, TLR9, 3, 7, TLR10. So there's a whole bunch of toll like receptors. And when the toll like receptors bind the PAMPs, then you get all this cell biology. You don't have to know. I just put that up there to traumatize you for something. And we've kind of gone over this with the phagocytes. So the phagocyte of interest in this cartoon would be what specific? What's the name?
The neutrophil?
The neutrophil, yeah. Again, multi-lobe nucleus. And we already talked about all this. So why did I put this in again? Huh. Oh. Because now I've got stuff in blue. So this is what you need to know for the test, that the neutrophils do this process of margination. That's where they stick to the capillary. And then they move through the capillary wall via diapedesis. And then they use chemotaxis along a chemical gradient to get to the battlefield. And then that's where they can do phagocytosis. And neutrophils specifically do the respiratory burst. Reason I wrote it this way, because it feels like the test question is like, these are the steps in neutrophil, when a neutrophil goes to the battlefield. And then I give you A, chemotaxis, margination, diapedesis. You know that's wrong. What would be the first step? What would be the right answer?
Margination.
Yeah, margination, diapedesis, chemotaxis, and then phagocytosis. So I think you have to know the events in correct order. Another cytokines secreted by all these white blood cells. They all secrete cytokines. So these are the cells, neutrophils, eosinophils, monocytes, and basophils. These are the cells, and this is what they secrete, cytokines. And then more proteins that are also in the blood that are in the second line of defense are these complement proteins. But we haven't talked about where they're made or what cell makes them. So they're a protein, they're a molecule, and they get made by cells in the liver. B, you are correct. Let's see, how close are we to getting down?
Yeah, I hear 10:55.
Yes.
Why don't we take a quick 7-minute break? Okay?